I'm Darius Spearman, and you're watching African Elements. Slavery in the Upper South wasn't as profitable as slavery in the Deep South plantations. As slavery phased out in the Upper South, the changing landscape created a setting that forged specific survival strategies for enslaved blacks. In this video, we'll explore how three of those survival strategies manifested for enslaved blacks in the Upper South. All that coming up next. Thank you for watching African Elements. If you're new to this channel, we create content in Black and Africana studies for higher education and bring it right here to where the people are at. If you'd like to see more of this content, make sure you drop a like and hit that subscribe button. To support this content even further, you can join our wonderful Patreon supporters and access ad-free videos for as little as a dollar a month. The link is below in the description. Previously, we discussed life and survival strategies on the slave plantations of the Deep South. In this episode, we're going to switch settings and talk about the dynamics that shaped the lives of enslaved blacks in the Upper South. Slavery in the Upper South differed from the Deep South. The Upper South's economy was primarily based on small-scale farming. In the Upper South, white farmers represented most of the slave owners, but they owned relatively few slaves. From 1830 to 1860, the percentage of Southern whites who owned slaves dropped dramatically from 36% to 4.7%. Even so, the slave population rose steadily amongst the increasingly fewer slave owners. As cotton grew to become the mainstay of the U.S. economy, accounting for 58% of all U.S. exports by 1860, slaveholders in the Upper South found slavery increasingly less profitable. That is, for small-scale farmers in the Upper South, the cost of feeding, clothing, and housing an enslaved workforce year-round was becoming increasingly difficult to justify. As slavery in the Deep South grew, the institution in the Upper South was thinning out. There, the trend among slave owners was divestment from slavery, but not without first wringing out every last bit of profit from the enslaved blacks they held in bondage. They did so in three primary ways. First, by hiring their slaves out. Second, by trafficking them to the Deep South through the domestic slave trade. And third, by sending them to the gold fields of California. Small-scale slave owners in the Upper South often chose to hire out their slaves for a set period, usually 7 years, and then set them free. Typically, the arrangement allowed enslaved blacks to work for wages while the slave owner connected a portion of their earnings. Such situations allowed the slave owner to profit from the slave's labor without the accompanying burden of providing room and board. Prominent examples include people such as Mary Ellen Pleasant. Pleasant's remarkable story touches on all three dynamics that shaped life in the Upper South that I discuss here. Born a slave, Pleasant was bonded out to a Quaker family in Nantucket, Virginia, and freed after 7 years of indenture. In Virginia, she became an operative on the Underground Railroad. This dangerous occupation ultimately forced her to flee west. Arriving in California in 1852, she amassed a multi-million dollar fortune and became a powerful political force in San Francisco. The Underground Railroad was active in the border states of Maryland, Delaware, Kentucky, Missouri, and Virginia. As such, slave owners in states bordering the free territories were incentivized to manumit their slaves, setting them free after a term of indenture. Doing so allowed them to both ensure profits and circumvent the risk of their slaves going fugitive. For this reason, manumission was a growing trend in the Upper South. The Underground Railroad helped enslaved blacks escape through a network of safe houses from the Upper South to the free communities in the northern states and Canada. Even before the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, escape through the Underground Railroad was a dangerous undertaking. As part of the Compromise of 1850, Congress passed the Fugitive Slave Act, which required fugitive slaves to be returned to their owners and imposed penalties on persons who aided in their escape. Escape via the Underground Railroad carried enormous risks. Unless they reached Canada, fugitive slaves lived with a constant threat of recapture and re-enslavement. Whippings, maimings, torture, and sometimes death awaited them on return. Slave catchers seeking rewards in the hundreds of dollars were in constant pursuit. Because of the danger, For many, the prospect of enduring 7 years of indenture in exchange for an assurance of freedom papers was a sensible alternative to a lifetime as a fugitive slave that immediate escape offered. The domestic slave trade, however, and the threat of being sold downriver to the growing plantations of the Deep South pushed many enslaved blacks to confront the risks of escape. After Congress banned the international slave trade in 1808, the domestic slave trade grew. Between 1830 and 1860, an estimated 50% of the slaves from the Upper South were trafficked to the plantations of the Deep South. Many enslaved blacks saw the dangerous life of a fugitive slave preferable to the dreaded fate of being sold down the river. As with Harriet Tubman, it was often the imminent threat of family separation through the domestic slave trade that pushed enslaved blacks to face the danger of escape on the Underground Railroad. California's admission into the Union in 1850, though, introduced a game-changing dynamic for blacks in the Upper South. California's admission to the Union, which accompanied the Compromise of 1850, brought both danger and opportunity. The danger came in the form of the Fugitive Slave Act discussed above. The Fugitive Slave Act, however, was part of a compromise that allowed California's ambition as a free state. The California State Constitution, which forbade slavery, was anything but a moral statement against the institution of slavery. By 1849, when the California Constitutional Convention met, the trend towards slavery as an institution in which enslaved blacks were concentrated into the hands of the increasingly fewer slaveholding elite was well underway. Henry Amos Taft, one of the delegates to the convention, bluntly stated his fear that slavery in California would become a monopoly of the worst character. The profits of the mines would go into the pockets of single individuals. Simultaneously, the trend toward emancipation in the Upper South, after having extracted every bit of profit from their slaves, was also a chief concern amongst the convention delegates. California's gold fields provided an even better opportunity for profit than selling enslaved blacks down the river. One of the delegates succinctly stated that concern during the convention debates. Suppose you pay $700 to get a slave here and set him free on the condition that he shall serve you for 1 year. He produces, according to the ordinary rates in the mines, from $2,000 to $6,000. There are many of our southern friends who would be glad to set their Negroes free and bring them here if it produced only half that amount. When the terms of the contract have expired, what would these slaves do? They would become a burden on the community. Despite their concerns, it's clear that many blacks took advantage of the opportunity to secure their freedom in California. In Sonoma County, for example, Samuel Shattuck was issued his free papers in 1852. In consideration of the meritorious services of Sam, a man of color and formerly a slave owned by me in the state of Louisiana, and for further consideration of his having served me for 2 years in California, as per agreement, I have emancipated and forever set free him, the said Sam, to be known hereafter as Samuel Shattuck, and by that name to act for himself and enjoy the benefit of his own contracts and labor in every aspect as any other free man. James Lynch, who came to California with a regiment of New York volunteers in 1847, wrote a poignant account of one of those freedom seekers named Jackson, who he encountered in Sacramento. In looking for a place to stay, we went into a hotel called the White House and were greeted by our old friend Jackson, who ran the Frisbee Hotel in Sonoma. Jackson was a Negro with a good deal of white blood in his veins and a celebrated caterer in his day. Jackson was married, but his wife was still a slave in Virginia, and it was his whole ambition to make enough money to buy her freedom. He would often take her picture out and show it to me. She too had a considerable mixture of white blood and was quite good looking. When I saw Jackson in Sacramento, he told me that he now had enough money to secure her freedom and would soon have her with him in California. All told, California blacks paid an estimated $750,000 to purchase their freedom for themselves and their families. So, we've explored three dynamics that shape black survival in the Upper South: the relative lack of profits for slave owners in the Upper South, the domestic slave trade, and the opening of California. Enslaved blacks adjusted their survival strategies accordingly. They either worked a term of indenture, escaped, or headed out west to California, where many secured freedom for themselves and their families. I know I've covered a lot of ground here, so please post any questions you may have in the comments. I'm Darius Spearman. Thank you for watching, and until next time, I'll see you in the comments.